Hi, everybody. This is Kara Swisher. I'm here with Audrey Tang, and we're going to talk a lot about privacy. All this privacy stuff was great. I'm not actually Kara Swisher. I've forgotten what it's like to be at a great privacy conference because they usually just try to steal all your information. So that's a pleasure. So let's actually get into that because, you know, Audrey, we talked about 6 months ago, I think, right in the middle of it. And Taiwan still has managed to really excel at what's happening with the pandemic and the response to it. I just want to sort of get an update from when we spoke before, because you were talking about all these different methodologies you were using. So I'd love you to sort of talk to me about what has worked and what hasn't worked to begin with, especially around privacy and also the protection of public health, are sometimes at cross purposes.
Yeah, nothing much have changed, which I guess is good news, right? We're still at around 10 COVID-related deaths. There's basically no lockdowns for the entire COVID-19 period, and we countered the pandemic with no lockdown specifically because we made sure that everybody understood the basic public health measures, including physical distancing and access to the PPEs, especially masks. We, I think, talk a little bit about how the open source applications, hundreds of them, help people locating the mask availability. And now we're moving, you know, beyond just having mask available. People are now wearing masks as fashion items, I guess. But then we're still keeping the basic reproduction value of both the virus and also the infodemic and conspiracy theories at firmly below one. And so we're largely post-pandemic. That hasn't changed.
Okay. So let's talk a little bit about the privacy implications and some of the things you were doing. It wasn't, you know, even in lots of countries, including the United States, that was difficult. And it wasn't over privacy issues. It was, I don't know quite what it was over, the lack of use of masks or just chuckleheadness is what we call it in this country. But what, talk a little bit about the issues around privacy, how you dealt with them, because I think one of the things that's been remarkable is this idea of, as I said, sometimes public health and privacy feel like they're at cross purposes. So can you sort of walk us through that?
Sure. So we use what we call a participatory self-surveillance in terms of re-decentralizing, for example, the contact system for a local outbreak to be monitored. Of course, you have to go back and look at who frequented that particular place in the past 14 days. But if we centralize all the records, that not only centralize the risk, but also makes the people who in their lines of work want to protect privacy. For example, people who are host or hostesses in the hostess bars in the nightlife district, they are the people that really would like to protect the identity, anonymity of their patrons. And so we actually did have a case last April when a hostess in a hostess bar initially didn't admit that she worked in that profession until the next day where she said, you know, I have to protect my clients and so on. But instead of putting the nightlife district to jail or fining them for not collaboration with the CECC, the Central Epidemic Command Center, we instead said that how about we co-create it from the first principles so that people can use throwaway SIM cards or ProtonMail mail accounts and so on and leave a contact without leaving a name on literally scratch pads when entering such businesses so that after 4 weeks with no local outbreak, they can literally shred it. And at no time do those information need to be aggregated or collected to the Central Epidemic Command Center, unless, of course, an outbreak happens. And that enabled the nightlife districts to essentially reopen in May, and that enabled Taiwan to avoid the situation in other jurisdictions where those, like the U.S. prohibition era, right, this business that's driven underground became the hazards to the pandemic.
So talk about this self-surveillance, this concept. I think it's, you know, the word surveillance terrifies a lot of people in privacy. And in general, it's sort of a malevolent word or used malevolently.
Sure.
So explain to the the concept of self-surveillance.
Sure. There's this term called surveillance, I think, Steve Mann term, that talks about how ordinary citizens armed with wearable cams, right, which was very fashionable when Steve Mann first started wearing it, but now everybody has a phone, and who could actually provide the kind of information that's needed to keep, for example, the public institutions accountable, or to, in our case, to make sure that the contact tracing still works. But because this surveillance is not a oversight, is a undersight in the term that people participating in it candidates understand exactly what they're doing, and the incentives are aligned so that the people who visit the Nalev district, the businesses and the workers, they are both aligned in their incentive in keeping each other healthy, but not mm-hmm. revealing each other's full identity to the wider community. And so this kind of self-surveillance in a participatory fashion enables the kind of public health measures that could go to the places where traditional top-down measures could not.
So talk about the idea of top-down measures, because the idea of doing it yourself has not caught on elsewhere, or it has caught on some places. So what does it take to create a feeling where you're self-surveilling and having your privacy protected at the same time?
Mm-hmm. I think one of the main things is that there needs to be a comprehensive communication platform or mimetic engineering that mm-hmm. talks about the rational self-interest of participating in such measures. For example, mm-hmm. when we talk about wearing masks, we didn't say wear it to protect the elderly. We didn't say wear it to respect the frontline health workers, mm-hmm. which are all true, but it doesn't appeal to rational self-interest. Rather, we say mm-hmm. wear a mask to protect your own face against your own unwashed hand. And this not only links mm-hmm. Hand sanitation mm-hmm. with mask use, but it actually is a viral meme that actually spreads because people are interested in protecting themselves against their own unwashed hands. Mm-hmm. And so that makes sure that everybody could share this message, remix this message, and mm-hmm. so it becomes truly grassroots.
So the grassroots in that you're saying this is about you, this is about selfishness, like you're going to protect you. One of right. the things you said when right. we talked before was when people I have to find it. There was a really good quote. The best ideas are the ones that take in most people's feelings, and then we turn that into a regulation.
That's right. Yes. So it's by responding to what people feel as important in the here and now, by responding in something that everyone can use. So that's empowerment, mm-hmm. right? Because they can turn the technology, in this case, mask and soap are useful chemical and physical vaccine technologies, and repurpose mm-hmm. this communication in a way that their community understands. And mask dispense, for example, is run by the community pharmacists who already mm-hmm. have the trust of the local elderly people, so that the people do not have to learn another like digital apparatus or to download this mm-hmm. NFC-enabled app or anything like that. They can continue to do whatever they were already doing, interacting with the people they already trust, just with this extra communication about public health.
Is there something different about the people of Taiwan as opposed to anywhere else where this didn't work? With this, mm-hmm. or it wasn't tried, I guess, is the point you're making.
Well, yeah, everyone above 30 years old in Taiwan remember how badly we managed SARS in 2003, mm-hmm. Which COVID mm-hmm. is technically, you know, SARS and COV2, so SARS 2.0, mm-hmm. right? So when SARS 1.0 hit Taiwan in 2003, we had exactly the same chaotic communications. People were panic buying all sorts of different mm-hmm. things. We had to lock down an entire hospital unannounced. It was very, very chaotic. So I think the main difference mm-hmm. Is just that in 2004, we learned from that memory when the trauma was still fresh and institutionalized mm-hmm. the kind of response that I was just sharing into not just our laws, but also our like yearly drills and so on.
Mm-hmm. And you called it that your model of government tech, at least, is founded on radical trust and transparency from mm-hmm. the government to the people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's about trusting the people from the government. The people may not trust the government. Maybe that's the better. Mm-hmm. But the mm-hmm. Korea Public Service really need to trust the citizens.
Mm-hmm. And don't is your feeling, or that you, what do you mean by that? The citizens have to trust the government, or the government?
The government need to trust the citizens in the sense mm-hmm. of trusting that the participatory measures are going to be mm-hmm. carried out by people who care about their own health and other neighbors' health, right? Mm-hmm. About trusting the citizens to use this real-time open data, open API of mask availability for good mm-hmm. and not for abuse, right? And trusting mm-hmm. the citizens to come up with social innovations, for example, about using traditional rice cookers to kill the virus and not kill the mask, which is right, essentially outside of its design purpose, but it's appropriate for the day, mm-hmm. right? And so all these is about social innovation that's initiated by the social sector. And this is what I mean by trusting the citizen to come up with mm-hmm. the measures. And if you mm-hmm. impose the top-down measures like lockdown and so on, then of course it decimates, like literally cut by 10% people's free agencies for each measure.
Right. So cutting their free agency in that it's been top-down and they just are told what to do and therefore resist it.
Exactly.
All right. So talk a little bit of the specifics of some of the things that you think worked better and stuff that didn't work as well. So you had the hotel, the hotel stays. That again was an area where privacy was a big issue in what people are doing. Talk a little bit about how you initiated that and what you think you changed and did better over time, or what didn't work initially.
There's a heuristic that we do not invent new data collection points during the pandemic. This is both out of necessity of the legal arrangement, because we never declare a state of emergency, so everything we do must be pre-approved by the legislature, and also because people understand the cybersecurity and privacy parameters of existing measures more, right? So it's less likely to result into abuse if we reuse existing data collection points. So for example,
this is a concept of don't take, there's an expression in the United States, please don't, there's not, crisis is always an opportunity. In this case, it's not a data opportunity.
No, it's not, because when you develop a greenfield code from scratch, it's very unlikely that you will understand the full cybersecurity and privacy implications, even for the best teams, and especially coding under pressure. But if we say, hey, when you're returning to Taiwan, you have to stay in your own residence or in a quarantine hotel for 14 days, and we're not going to ask you to install an app, but your SIM card, your phone number will be hacked in the telecoms, and they're not going to send it to third-party processors. They're going to use exactly the same mechanism that they notify you in advance of the earthquakes or the flood evacuation warnings and so on, based on triangulation. So it doesn't know which room you're in. It can't interface with your email or WhatsApp, but it does know to roughly 50-meter radius that you're breaking out of the quarantine, in which a automatic SMS is first sent to your phone and then to the local health offices. And if they check on you and you're not there, then SMS is sent to the police officers. But that is applied with equity, and everybody understands that basically it all gets deleted after 4 weeks. The whole point is that if people understand what's already going on, then the privacy boundaries and measures are upheld by the people, because everybody feels it's proportional. But if it's new code, whether it's proportional or not is a matter of great debate.
Meaning that it doesn't get to the certain people are affected and others are not.
Exactly.
So that in terms of any mistakes you made in doing that, was there something that you had to correct? Was there something that didn't work?
Yeah, a simple thing is that in the very beginning, like early February last year, we had to basically improvise a lot of ways to ramp up our mass production. In a country of 23 million, we originally had less than 2 million a day production for medical grade mask. And we eventually improved our production to more than 20 million a day, but it takes time, right? So for a couple of days, the CECC was saying, maybe for healthy people in public transportation that's well ventilated, maybe you don't have to wear the mask all the time. And we faced such a backlash. People were saying, you know, it's the state's duty to make the mask that people need. So we really had to do a U-turn around 48 hours afterwards. Of course, I guess other jurisdictions did a U-turn 48 days afterward or many months afterwards. But I think that's a mistake in the very early days. And after that, when we rolled out the mask availability map, there was also a data quality, or rather a data bias issue, in that because we publish the numbers of every 30 seconds the people's purchase, and we were initially quite happy because the pharmacy's locations almost overlap exactly with the population center. So we felt that every individual in Taiwan are roughly the same distance away from the pharmacy loaded with medical grade mask. And so in a kind of Taipei-based viewpoint, this is fair, right? But just after a couple of weeks, a MP from an opposition party, the Taiwan People's Party, MP Gao Hong-an, she is the VP of Data Analytics in Foxconn, before joining the parliament, so she knows something about data, and she analyzed it with the OpenStreetMap community, saying it's actually not true, because while it's the same distance by helicopter, if people are in rural areas and had to take public transportation, maybe by the time they reach the pharmacy has already closed, so the time opportunity cost is not the same. There is bias in this data, and because it's evidence-based interpolation, Minister Chen of CECC didn't defend the policy. He just said, legislator, teach us. And then we start co-creating, and just 24 hours after, we change the distribution mechanism, and we also introduce pre-ordering to the convenience store that opened 24 hours a day.
And then keeping health records of people and how they do it is obviously important, because when we look back on this, it's going to be critically important. Talk a little bit about what privacy projections you wanted to put mm-hmm. in there, because you know I know a lot of people who don't want people to know they had COVID, mm-hmm. or know they got a vaccine. It's a lot of secretiveness attached mm-hmm. to it, and I'm not sure what that is at this moment here mm-hmm. in this country, at least. But how do you deal with those issues?
Mm-hmm. Well, the main thing is that the national healthcare system, which is universal healthcare, which covers not mm-hmm. just citizens but also residents and everyone who used the mm-hmm. gold card to enter Taiwan, also enjoy the healthcare. We made sure that by law, this IC card only stores your data in a way that's disaggregated with pretty much anything else. It could only mm-hmm. be used in medical services and other public services that's pre-registered with the mm-hmm. National Health Insurance Agency, and it's never interfacing any other entities in the economic sector or other sectors. And so because mm-hmm. of that, people could rest assured that every transaction that they do with this universal health card is recorded, that's true, it's centralized, that's true, but it's not connected to the wider internet, and it's not mm-hmm. going to be used in anything that's not a designated purpose public service. And everybody can also keep that to account by downloading the NHI app. There's more than 5 million people downloading that in the last year. They used it not only to pre-order masks or dedicate their mask rations to international humanitarian aid, but also to check all their visits to their dentists, to their mm-hmm. doctors, downloading x-ray scans. I think even CT scans could be downloaded and analyzed locally on the phone. And so they participate in this data collaborative, that they are the active participant who not can only choose what to participate in, for example, the mask donation stuff, but also to correct the data pertaining to them if they the data are wrong. So this is about the participatory auditing and control.
Mm-hmm. And talk a little bit about targeting of people to get them to do things. One of the things that you said to me last time we talked was two things. The more trust you place in the citizens, the more trustworthy they become. Mm-hmm. And instead of asking people to come to technology, bring yeah. technology to where people are. Talk about the idea of trust, because I think one of the issues around privacy is the lack of trust that you're mm-hmm. saying these things, but it's not what actually happens or mm-hmm. things leak, or whether they're by hacking or just by accident or malevolence or just mm-hmm. trying to do a better business.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think the main thing about getting trust is to admit failures or U-turns mm-hmm. or saying mm-hmm. legislator teach us when a mm-hmm. mistake or bias has been pointed out early on. If we let it linger, or if we respond only after a quarter or two, or if we respond by saying, you know, this is an emergency mm-hmm. respond when the pandemic is over, then of course that's over. We don't earn any trust this way. So I think a lot of it is about a timely response in the here and now. In the last year alone, there's more than 2 million phone calls called to the hotline, the toll-free number 1922, where everyone can get their privacy questions answered in the call center, and even mm-hmm. unrelated questions that call center cannot handle. For example, last April, there was a young boy who called saying, "You're Rationale mask, but why am I only getting the pink ones? All the boys in my class got mm-hmm. navy blue ones, and I don't want to wear pink to school. I'm a boy." And then just 24 hours afterwards, everybody in the CECC wore pink, and then pink became the most trending color for quite a while. Mm-hmm. And so this kind of rapid response, this agile methodology, makes sure that we continuously integrate people's feedback. I think that garners trust.
When you think about this, part of the mistrust has to do with polarization and misinformation. And mm-hmm. it's another thing that you tried to deal with, because mm-hmm. it creates a feeling of that this information is not being used correctly, or going to other information that may seem more trustworthy to you in mm-hmm. some way, or that you are being watched. I mean, it works rather well in this country that they know what you're doing. Or, you know, right now the rumor around vaccines is that Bill Gates is putting a chip in your vaccine and therefore it's going to track you. Mm-hmm. I asked him, he said that
like
it's not the case.
Antenna as yeah. part of the mask or something.
Yeah.
I've read
it. Yeah. So talk mm-hmm. about how you deal with that, because there are, you know, generalized feelings about privacy and surveillance mm-hmm. that are still, you know, it's not the worst thing to be worried about, but it can turn very ugly and get in the way of vaccines or mask wearing or other things like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think one of the main thing about the disinformation or infodemic, as I prefer to call it, is that it's really a symptom. And the root cause is sometimes that the participatory nature of getting the truth, figuring it out together. I'll just call it journalism, because in Taiwan, news work and journalism is the same Mandarin word. So if everyone think about how can we contribute to the common sensing of what's really happening, if people feel that they are empowered, for example, during our election, during the counting process, everyone is invited, even YouTubers and so on, to film the entire paper-based counting process. So even if people distrust the opposition party and only trust their party's YouTubers are armed with not just a mobile phone with camera, but also with an app, a custom app that can count the tallying in real time and synchronize that with the video footage. So if the different, like three different political parties, YouTubers agree on the counts, then there's really not much room for the conspiracy theory about the election process to go viral. But if people do not feel that they can actually go in and cover this whole thing, if this, you know, magic box is doing all the counting and so on, then of course that is the root cause. And the disinformation we see is mostly just a symptom.
Well, sometimes they just don't believe it, even if you give them deep proof of things, correct?
Yeah, surely. But just like the herd immunity, getting enough amount of people in the population to participate in just a little bit of fact-checking, just a little bit of news work, builds, I guess, herd immunity in that even if a certain individual believes a certain thing and shared, it's less likely that other people who have participated in the fact-finding will reshare that piece of conspiracy theory. And as long as the R value is under one, it would not go viral.
Right. So you're talking about the R value, which is a virus value too. When you are thinking of this, then what are some of the surveillance and privacy worries that you had to push back? What were the most difficult ones? I think in this, there's depends on the group in the United States and other places, but you know, some cases they've had bad experiences with vaccine. In other cases, there's a whole thing around stem cells, religious people thinking it was, you know, stem cells were used in these things. There's all kinds of things that other people don't want to be tracked by Bill Gates and his mythical chip that he puts in the vaccine. So what are some of the more outlandish ones, and how did you deal with them there in Taiwan? Or maybe you didn't have them because you're better people. I don't know.
With vaccines or masks. We did have a conspiracy theory that says the state is confiscating all the tissue paper material to make masks. So we're run out of tissue paper, soon go out and buy. And people really did go out and buy, and there's no tissue papers for a morning or two. But it was countered by this very funny meme that's rolled out by our premier's office, with our premier wiggling his bum and saying very large font, each of us only have a pair of Botox. And is it wordplay? Because in Mandarin, to stockpile tuan sounds exactly the same as bottom tuan. And so basically he's saying we can't use that many anyway. And that went viral. And with that, a very clear table saying the tissue papers are made out of South American materials and a medical grade mask are actually plastic product. They're made out of domestic material. So there's no way that making the mask to 20 million a day will hurt any of the production lines of the tissue papers. And just after a couple of days, the rumor died down.
So what is it, was there anything that you dealt with that you were worried about on people's privacy? One of the things I'm thinking about right now is this sort of, it's starting to be somewhat of a controversy, is this vaccine passport idea, that you have proof of vaccine, that this is a surveillance problem, and that some people get to participate and some don't if they don't have the vaccine. You talk about, you know, you've moved into the vaccine phase. What is that something that you all think about and how you would roll that out?
Well, we had a lot of vaccines, the flu vaccines and so on. The availability of the vaccine shots and so on are already tracked in an interactive map. And so we just change a few parameters, and now you can check the, you know, COVID-19 vaccine places. It's exactly the same system. Again, we don't invent new data collection or use points. We just treat it exactly as any other vaccination process. And your vaccination record is in the NHI app. You can, of course, download the NHI app and look at all your visits to vaccination exactly as any other vaccines. But people are opting in. I mean, we're not really in a rush because we've got plenty of physical vaccine, that's the mask, and our value is still very much below one, and we don't have any local confirmed cases for quite a while now, and so people are just taking their time. But for the frontline health workers, and later on for the diplomats, I guess, people who are going to the Tokyo Olympic, of course, they're going to get vaccines.
What is the vaccine uptake in the country right now?
It's just started. So we did not at the moment have more than the doses required for the medical workers, the frontline workers. I think it will be another couple months before our locally, domestically produced vaccine get an EUA, at which time, of course, we'll have plenty of vaccine and also to help other countries.
So one of the things you also told me was, we just have a few more minutes, but internet affordability is considered a healthcare right, like healthcare a right. Is privacy that same thing? Is it a right among your citizens? How do you, you know, because there is some bit of watching and monitoring them, and you're trying to get their cooperation, but do you feel like it's also a right of people to have?
Definitely. I think privacy is not just a core human right, but I would also like to say that the digital spaces need to respect the same kind of norms that we come to expect in the analog places. That is to say, the expected norms need not to be disrupted, quote unquote, just because you're in part of a digital public infrastructure as opposed to an analog public infrastructure. So a digital town hall, for example, carries the same privacy expectations to an analog town hall. The same would apply to universities, learning places, national parks, and things like that. And if we ask people to change their norm expectations drastically, I think it's not just a human rights problem, but it's also a governance problem.
Meaning
that if people behave expecting that there's certain privacy guarantees because they're acting, for example, in the national e-petition platform, we make sure that people could post pseudonymously so people feel safe and they could post some whistleblowing stuff. And people who are not 18 years old still enjoy the full citizens' initiative rights and so on. But if we disrupt that guarantee and reveal their real identity to their employers, to the schools, and so on, just because it's digital and we could trick them into revealing their organizations or whatever, then we're violating that guarantee. So it's not just about being legal or not. It's about people behaving in a digital public infrastructure in a way that people come to feel as a safe space and therefore contributing whatever their real experiences is to the public decision making.
Are there any differences, though? There are differences in, between a digital and a public space. I mean, an analog public space.
Well, there's, I think, two main differences. The main thing about the digital space is that, because in Mandarin, digital sounds the same as plural, shu wei, right? So the digital minister is plural minister. So it means that each appearance could be remixed theoretically. It could, if you speak here in this private conference, it could be actually be screen captured and remixed and used in another place, right? And this place may respect all your norms. But that remix place may violate the norms. So the downstream-wise, a norm that propagates to the remixes and reuses, that's going to be very important. That's the first one. And the second one, of course, there are the ways of impersonation of getting identity of other people through cybersecurity means. That's simply not possible thanks to a law of physics in the analog space.
So what are your greatest worries around privacy after having this experience? Also, what do you think the most important things to take away for you? We just said about 2 minutes. And what are your greatest worries going into? Because, you know, in all looking at it overall, it's a huge success. You've had a huge success that was not replicated in other places. So when you're thinking about that, what do you think, what are your greatest worries or things you think are important for people to keep in mind, especially around when it comes to privacy?
Yeah, I think my main worry is that other jurisdictions in the world, maybe not learning about Taiwan's model, will falsely think that the top-down, lockdown, shutdown, takedown is the only way to counter a pandemic or an infodemic. And my main worry is that, like political capitalism, both the surveillance state and the surveillance capitalist will see this as the golden opportunity to encroach on the civil liberties and build a new norm that forces people to accept to the sacrifice of their privacies and their self-agency. The reason why we're sharing this Taiwan model so much is not just because it's a great thing public health and economy-wise, but also it deepens democracy and privacy and civil rights even during the pandemic. Actually, because of that, we counter a pandemic better.
And when you look around the world where people had, were you worried about some efforts that were made that were successful that did violate privacy issues? Was that a worry of yours? Because there were lots of ways to control a population.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Well, Dr. Li Wenliang, the original whistleblower from Wuhan PRC, did save the Taiwanese people because his message that, and I quote, there's seven new SARS cases in the Huanan seafood market, end of quote, did make rounds to PTT, the Taiwanese digital public infrastructure subsidized by the National Taiwan University with no advertisers or shareholders, and people triaged that, and that ended up resulting in just after 24 hours with our health inspection for all five passengers coming in from Wuhan. But the same message did not reach the Wuhan people, and because of their harmonization, right, things. And that, of course, could have actually saved people in Wuhan. And maybe it did reach the other social medias in the world, but maybe because there's more noise than signals, maybe it's like, you know, not public but private infrastructure, like a nightclub with very loud music. You have to shout to get heard, people serving toxic drinks and with private bouncer and so on. So it really did not reach the kind of rough consensus that the Taiwan people reached around the same message. So getting that kind of message spread and into the radar of everyone and building an actionable rough consensus, I think that's the main thing we all need to do after this particular pandemic.
Well, that's a great end, rough consensus. That's a great way to put it. Thank you, Audrey. Really appreciate it, Minister Tang. And thank you so much for doing this.
Thank you. Live long and prosper.
Thank you. Thank you, Spock. Thank you.